Hello and welcome back to another day in the arena. It's me, it's CGB, today in the arena. A little bit of a different video for you guys. We are going to be talking about the most overrated cards in Kaldheim, according to me, CGB. A bit of an opinion piece, a little bit of card talk, and it comes for a good reason. As when I stream, I often get asked why not a certain card. In fact, it's probably the most... If you could put questions into groups, it's probably the most asked question on the stream by far. No matter what deck I play, no matter what I'm doing, I'll always be asked by people joining the stream why I don't play a certain card. And some cards I get asked about over and over and over and over again. A few all-timers for the channel, by the way, are Dawn of Hope and Reliquary Tower, if you remember those. So going back to those, it's... really hard to answer that question in the middle of a stream. You don't want to launch into a monologue about how you feel about a card or what a card's issues are every time somebody asks, because you get asked this question sometimes hundreds of times in a stream. And because of that, often the reply is quick, because streamers want to let you know that we're paying attention to chat. So we'll say, I'm not playing this card because it's not good. The truth is that the card is good, and that what we said isn't 100% correct. Oftentimes, the card actually is good, but it's wrong for the deck. And when we're saying that a card is wrong for a deck, and when people are constantly asking about that card, I think that that leads you to a place of, well, I think that this card, just in the minds of players, is an auto-include in every deck that plays the colors for this card. And that, in my mind, defines what an overrated card is on MTG Arena. A card that people play despite the colors, despite the theme of the deck, because they think the card is that good that it should just go into all these decks. So, when we talk about the most overrated cards in Kaldheim, that's the criteria. It doesn't mean the card is bad. In fact, many of these cards are actually going to be quite good in the right deck. However, it doesn't mean that it goes in every single deck that matches the colors. And we're going to start it off with a banger. Sir Wolf, Realm Eater. This is a one in a black legendary wolf. I am going to read the cards for this specific video because many people might see them for the first time. This is a 3/3. Whenever a permanent an opponent controls is put into a graveyard from the battlefield, put a +1/+1 counter on Sir Wolf Realm Eater. At the beginning of your upkeep, if Sir Wolf has one or more +1/+1 counters on it, you may remove all of them. If you do, exile each other non-land permanent with converted mana cost less than or equal to the number of counters removed this way. This wolf, it's got a few problems. First of all, on its own, if you just straight up cast it, it's a 3-mana 3/3. That body doesn't quite hold up. A Kazandu Mammoth has this dual role of being a land, but also getting +2/+2 whenever you play a land, so it's already much better than a Sir Wolf the Realm Eater. It's hard to even picture what Sir Wolf here wants to rumble with in combat, and if this card lives and untaps, now you have to start removing the opponent's permanents, because trust me, they're not going to do it for you on MTG Arena. By the way, I can't stress this enough. I am talking about MTG Arena. It's in the title. I'm not talking about formats that aren't on MTG Arena. This is a great example of that too. Most of the cards I'm going to talk about are amazing cards for Commander. Amazing cards for casual formats, and might be really good cards in older formats as well. But Sir Rolf of the Neon Socks here needs a lot of support in Standard, and I think it's going to be too slow. The only hope I see for the card is in a deck really built around it that uses In Search of Greatness, so that you get to cast it for free. Then you get to remove things with your open mana using cards like Heartless Act and Eliminate, and then on the next upkeep, you might activate Sir Wolf the Realm Eater, which might destroy your In Search of Greatness, nullifying even the power of that free effect. So for me, this is easily one of the most overrated cards in the set. Number nine is a bit of a cheat. I'm going to put 10 different cards into the number nine slot, and we're going to call it the Cycle of Guild Sacrifice Effect Lands. and those are Axeguard Armory, Bretagard Stronghold, Gates of Istfell, Knotvold Slumber Mound, Great Hall of Starnhelm, Immersterum Skullcairn, Skemfar Elder Hall. These are fun to say, by the way. Jara Mirror Lake, Port of Carfell, and Surtland Frostpyre. These are tap lands that tap for one mana of a color, and then if you tap the guild mana and a bit more mana and you sacrifice the land, you get some kind of effect. Many can only be activated at sorcery speed. Some can be activated at instant speed. Why do I call these overrated? Because I know for sure that every single deck I play that has these color combinations, people will ask me why I'm not running these cards in them. And it's because a tap land is a very serious cost in a multicolor deck. It's already hard enough to get by with temples and fabled passage and the pathways. The pathways are easily the best, but if you don't draw them, plus triomes, you know, triomes are still getting played if these have more three or more colors. But anyway, if you draw too many of these, if you draw multiple tap lands, if you draw a tap land and a fabled passage and a temple, if you play tap lands for most of the early turns, you will get run over in Arena, especially in Best of One. Aggro still rules the day. Arena benefits aggro quite a bit because fast matches, fast grinds are a thing, and tap lands really hurt you. Not to mention that most of the effects look good, but they're secretly not very good. The opponent sees them. They're sitting on the battlefield for a full turn before they can be used. And the next turn, the opponent can play around it, either by holding up removal, in the case of the Simic one that copies things, or holding back creatures, in the case of Surtland Frostpyre, which sweeps creatures and does 2 damage to multiple creatures. On top of all of that, you have to sacrifice the land. You have to sacrifice the land. And if you do, you have one less land to use. Now, there was a time in Magic where we would end up with all these lands on the battlefield and nothing to do with them. And there are some decks that can play out this way sometimes. But nowadays, there's so much card draw attached to every single card, and it has so much text that really you need all of your lands to keep making sure that things are happening every turn of the game. And sacrificing a land means that you make less things happen on your future turns, even if you already have 5 or 6. The one that I think is an exception that should see a good amount of play is Immersterum Skullcairn, which almost every kind of mid-range and some aggro Rakdos decks should at least play one or two of these. But for the most part, I would consider these cards a one of or a zero if you want to be absolutely sure that your mana works and you see the benefit on these cards as negligible and not very likely to come up. So I am definitely putting these in an extremely overrated category because I know I'm going to have to constantly answer the question on stream, or I'm going to see the comments on every video. Why aren't you playing this land? Because you're in these color combinations. Why aren't you playing it? The answer is, I don't think they're quite as good as everybody else does. Number 8 is Starnheim Unleashed. This is a 2 white-white sorcery, create a 4/4 Angel Warrior token with flying and vigilance. If this spell was foretold, create X of those tokens instead. Foretell XX white. So the way that foretell works is that on your turn, you can pay 2 generic mana at any time on your turn to exile it, and then you may cast it on a future turn for the foretell cost at the speed of the card, in this case a sorcery. The biggest problem with this is that on its own, 4 mana for a 4/4 flying vigilant angel is only okay by current standards. It's fine, it's not great. The big problem is that you look at that white XX make X angels and you're like, oh, I can draw this late in the game. I can make an army of angels and it will take over the game. Well, not so fast. Foretell demands that you pay the 2 and exile the card on a different turn. You have to cast it on a later turn. If you draw this off the top in a top deck battle, then you have to pay 2 to exile it, and the next turn you can make those angels, and the turn after that they actually get to attack. That, to me, is too many turns off, and I don't think I'm going to be doing much with Starnheim Unleashed, although I may Experiment with it in a specifically focused Fortel deck, maybe possibly using the card Cosmos Charger, which lets you play it at flash speed, which would change things significantly. So put me as a no way on a Starnheim Unleashed, except in a very focused deck. But the fact that I'm already getting asked about it for my blue-white control decks tells me that this is going to be one of the most overrated cards in the set. Coming in at number 7 is the Raven's Warning, another blue and a white saga. Since a lot of this video is shaped by basically having people ask me why I don't play this card, you can tell I play a lot of blue-white cards because we've got multiple white and blue cards already. So the Raven's Warning is one and a white enchantment saga. You create a 1/1 bird token with flying and you gain 2 life. Chapter 2 is whenever one or more creatures you control with flying deal combat damage to a player this turn, look at the player's hand and draw a card. Chapter 3, you may put a card you own from outside the game on top of your library. So right away, Chapter 3 doesn't work in Brawl or Commander, so is this a standard card? 3 mana for a 1/1 bird that gives you 2 life is not a good Chapter 1. So now at this point, we're basing the power of the card on Chapters 2 and Chapter 3. I think that what a lot of people I think the big, huge problem with this card that a lot of people forget, if the bird or the flyers don't connect with the opponent, you don't get the card. That's one problem. They probably remember that. But what if the Raven's Warning is removed, say by a Skyclave's Apparition or a Gem Razor? Then you'll never get to draw the card. You'll never get to look at the hand, and you'll never get the tutor effect on Chapter 3. So this card has two glaring weaknesses. If the Raven's Warning is removed, all you got was a 1/1 bird. That's not very good. If the bird is removed, you don't get to draw the card. That's not very good either. And while the tutor might still be helpful, at that point you might be too far behind in the game for it to actually save you. So for me, the card is very circumstantial, very specific. Somebody said, why not in a Flyers focus deck? Because I think that if you're in a Flyers focus deck, you better be killing the opponent, and 3 mana for a 1/1 with 2 life isn't doing that. So for me, the Raven's Warning is not a card I plan to put in very many decks. I'm not even sure this will make it into any of my decks, to be honest. So this goes on my list of the most overrated cards in the set. Card number 6 is our first red card, Quakebringer. 3, red, 5/4, Giant Berserker, Mythic. Your opponents can't gain life. At the beginning of your upkeep, Quakebringer deals 2 damage to each opponent. This ability triggers only if Quakebringer is on the battlefield or if Quakebringer is in your graveyard and you control a giant. Fortel, 2 red. For a lot of people are really excited about giants, and whenever there's a new tribe that is specifically pushed, the fans of that tribe who never got the push come out of the woodwork and get very excited about it. Giants is definitely a flavor of the month, and without question, I'm going to play and build some giant decks. But Quakebringer specifically doesn't have a lot of text that excites me. 5 mana for a 5/4 that doesn't even have trample, that doesn't have first strike, that doesn't have any other abilities, no menace, that kind of help it with combat somehow. Haste would have been a killer one. Without those abilities, I think it's really lacking in terms of a creature on the battlefield. But it has some other text. Your opponents can't gain life has shown up relevant here and there, but it's way too slow to slow down a Speaker of the Heavens, if that ever got ruling. So I'm even skeptical of how the can't gain life effect works. If that worked from the graveyard too, I would be more excited about the card, but it's only while Quakebringer is in play. Speaking of the graveyard ability, it only triggers if you control another giant. The problem there is if all the giants are dead, which is something a control deck is going to be trying to do anyway, then you don't get the ability. I think the best home for Quakebringer would be against aggro decks, because if they don't have that much removal in their deck and you're able to stick a few giants, sit back on defense, and have the Quakebringer that died earlier in the game slowly whittle down their life total so that you could just keep giant beefy walls in front of an Embercleave, then maybe you're doing something good with the card. But in my world, this is a very conditional card. And as much as I would love the idea that you resolve one Bone Crusher Giant and then the rogue player mills you and you have three of these and the opponent takes six every turn, I think that the rogue player is just going to kill all your giants and beat you to death anyway. And I don't think that Quakebringer is going to work out very well, but this is a card that people are already asking me to play in almost every red deck, and I think it's one of the most overrated cards in the set. Number five is going to make some people mad. I can feel the comments raging. It's Mystic Reflection. This is one in a blue instant. Choose target non-legendary creature. The next time one or more creatures or planeswalkers enter the battlefield this turn, they enter as copies of the chosen creature instead. Foretell for one blue. Let me get this out of the way. This card is sweet. This card is very, very sweet, and I do like it. The reason it is my fifth most overrated card in the set, oh, by the way, it's at literally Kaldheim number 69. That can't be an accident. It's literally card number 69 in the set. Anyway, leave a nice in the comments if you find that funny. But the problem here is that this card demands a few things going well for you. The opponent has to control a smaller creature if you want to turn their large creature or planeswalker into something small. The opponent can remove the thing that you target at instant speed and fizzle Mystic Reflection. Mystic Reflection requires that you have a way to make tokens and that another very good creature be on the battlefield that you are able to target with Mystic Reflection that doesn't get removed. So the Foretell helps with that a lot. Being able to do this for one instant makes it much more flexible, so I'm glad it has that. But what I'm saying is that the card doesn't just go in any blue deck. It goes in very specific decks. Decks that can take advantage of the card, both for you and against the opponent. So decks that maybe give the opponent illusion tokens from Skyclave Apparition while having Skyclave Apparition itself. Decks that play Omen of the Sun that can make two tokens at once and then turn them into something better like Skyclave Apparition or Dream Trawler. So immediately people will see, shouldn't this just go into any deck with something like a Skyclave Apparition? And I think the answer is no. I think you have to design your deck in such a way to really set up and play and make happen excellent Mystic Reflections. So while I will build several decks around Mystic Reflection, I'm not going to put it in the decks that are not designed around Mystic Reflection. And so far, I continue to have people asking me to put it in each blue-white deck that I theorycraft for the new set, into each Dimir deck I theorycraft for the new set. Any deck with blue right now, I'm being asked, why not Mystic Reflection? And the answer is because I don't think it's a generically good card that goes in every deck that plays blue or wants some kind of a counter or removal effect. I think it is a very specific card that goes in a deck that can both utilize it with your own creatures and utilize it against the opponent. And because of that, I think you build around Mystic Reflection. I don't think you put Mystic Reflection in decks that aren't built around it. So that's why I consider it a very overrated card. Number four, Isika, God of the Tree. This is a wall of text, a one green legendary creature god vigilance, tap, add one mana of any color. Other legendary creatures you control have vigilance and tap, add one mana of any color. 1/4, with the other side being the Prismatic Bridge, which is a white, blue, black, red, green, a Wooborg, if you will, a legendary enchantment. At the beginning of your upkeep, reveal cards from the top of your library until you reveal a creature or planeswalker card. Put that card onto the battlefield and the rest on the bottom in any order. And I consider this a very excellent commander card and a card that will definitely also brew our kind of god and legendary theme deck around that might be very good, but this doesn't go into every single deck that plays green, and it definitely doesn't go into five color control decks for the Prismatic Bridge necessarily. The Prismatic Bridge has multiple issues. Number one, has to wait till the next upkeep, the Outlaw's Merriment issue. Number two, it hits any creature or planeswalker card, and if you run Isika, God of the Tree in your deck, and you probably have a few of them because your deck sort of works around this kind of thing, and it definitely needs the mana fixing, So there's a good chance you'll just hit another Asika, or you'll hit a lower impact creature or planeswalker. So with the randomness of that and not being sure that you'll hit something that matters, and the fact that you have to wait till the next upkeep, and the fact that it's difficult to cast, I don't think the Prismatic Bridge is a card that you can slot into most decks. I built a 5-color shrine deck. Immediately people wanted me to play the Prismatic Bridge. I don't think that makes sense. It doesn't even hit shrines. It only hits creatures or planeswalkers. Good moment of read the card. The front side is okay, but 3-mana for a 1/4 Vigilant that taps for a mana wouldn't be played in Standard on its own. It's a little bit slow and not great. The ability to use it with other legendary creatures, especially Magda, is pretty cool. But this is definitely another case of a sweet card for Commander and a sweet card to brew a deck around, to really try to maximize what's going on with the card. But you don't put it in every single deck that plays the color green. So for me, Asika, God of the Tree, is the number 4 most overrated card in Kaldheim. Number 3, King Narfi's Betrayal. This is a 1 and a blue and a black saga. Number 1, each player mills 4 cards. You may exile up to 1 creature or planeswalker card from each graveyard. Chapters 2 and 3 say the same thing. Until the end of turn, you may cast spells from among cards exiled with King Narfi's Betrayal, and you may spend mana as though it were mana of any color to cast those spells. Why is this one overrated? Seems pretty cool. It's 3 mana, each player mills, and then you draw 2 in a way, because you exile 2 cards, and then you get to cast them on future turns. When your deck can take advantage of the mill effect in multiple ways, this is a very tempting option, and I might well try it in things like Rogues. It'll definitely get tried in Turbo Mill. Like, without question, people are going to play this with Runecrab and Teferi's Tutelage and things like that. But I don't think that it should be automatic in Demir Control. I don't think this should be automatic in Sultai. I think that the big problem that people miss on this is that the card King Narfi's Betrayal has to be on the battlefield for chapters 2 and 3 to work. There are several cards right now that if you exile cards with them, you can play them on future turns regardless of whether or not you control the card that did the exiling. But King Narfi's Betrayal is not one of them. This card, if you mill 4 cards and then you exile a sweet card from their graveyard and a sweet planeswalker from your graveyard, but the next turn the opponent gem razors the Betrayal, or Skyclave Apparitions the Betrayal, or Elspeth Conquers Deaths the Betrayal, or even Brazen Borrows it, Chapter 2 and Chapter 3 don't go off, and you don't get to cast the spells. There's also the timing issue that you pretty much foretell, that is a joke, your own turns. The opponent knows that you're going to play these cards because you only have Chapter 2 and Chapter 3 going on, 2 turns to play them. So the opponent can adjust their plays around the cards, so it's very face-up. They might be very choice cards, or you might whiff. There's also the randomness factor. So for me, King Narfi's Betrayal is a little bit too narrow and not the automatic draw to that I think some people believe it is. And I consider it, based on the amount of people begging me to play it in my Yorian piles and the Esper Doom piles, I definitely consider it one of the most overrated cards in the set. Number 2 of the most overrated cards in Kaldheim is Orvar the Allform. Orvar the Allform is 3 and a blue for a legendary creature shapeshifter changeling. Whenever you cast an instant or sorcery spell, if it targets one or more other permanents you control, create a token that's a copy of one of those permanents. When a spell or ability an opponent controls causes you to discard this card, create a token that's a copy of target permanent 3/3. Easily the finest of hill giants ever printed. Back in my day, we paid 4 mana for a 3/3 do nothing, and we liked it. This is a very sweet card that is going to create all kinds of fun decks for the jank brewers. 100%. Like, just getting this out there and trying to make multiple copies of many things on the battlefield does sound epic and extremely fun. I expect at least there is a shell that might be competitive in the form of with the Goldspan Dragon, one of the best cards in the set, because targeting the dragon makes treasures, and targeting the dragon also copies the dragon if you control Orvar. However, Orvar is very vulnerable, and this is another card that I'm constantly getting asked to completely reshape my deck ideas around. This is a card that doesn't just go into any deck, at least not until straight up discard effects are just automatic in every deck. Obviously, when the opponent forces you to discard this, you get to create a token that's a copy of target permanent. It can be a creature. You can just copy a land. That's awesome. So this might see considerable sideboard play, but that requires a very specific meta and a place where people are forcing you to discard things. Haha, Kroxa, for example. And this card definitely, as the theme of the video indicates, it doesn't go in every deck. It's a very sweet commander deck. Very, very sweet commander card. And there are going to be some very, very sweet cards and decks built around this thing. It's going to lead to some interesting archetypes, and it's going to lead to some wonderful moments in Magic. So I'm a big fan, but it doesn't go into every single blue deck, and it doesn't even go into every single blue deck that has instants or sorceries. It's another example of a card that you should be building around, not a card that just automatically goes into the deck because it's those colors. And because of that, that's why it's on this list, because I have already tried to build so many blue decks that get completely derailed because the chat wants to know how Orvar the All Form fits into those decks. And it's always an adventure to have to stop and say, well, this card would be great with this and this, but you don't usually want to be targeting your own things with this instant or sorcery very much. Also, for those of you saying Mystic Reflection, remember that Mystic Reflection says non-legendary creature. That's going to put a big ugh in that little vibe that you had, that you were going to use Mystic Reflection with this and put two overrated cards onto one stack. But anyway, this is going to be fun. It's just not for every single blue deck, and in the end, it probably won't be in the most competitive of builds, although it might break through here and there, especially in sideboards. The number one most overrated card in Kaldheim, not close, the card that people cannot stop asking me if it will be banned, telling me it's insanely broken, telling me that every game is now all about this card, telling me that the color pie is now completely destroyed, telling me that Magic the Gathering is coming to an end. The number one most overrated card in the set is the World Tree. The World Tree enters the battlefield tapped. It taps for green. And as long as you control six or more lands you control have tap, add one mana of any color. And then, for double Wooburg and a tap, sacrifice the World Tree to search your library for any number of god cards and put them onto the battlefield, then shuffle your library. Like so many other cards on this list, this is not a bad card. I am not calling this card garbage. I'm not saying it's trash. In fact, I can't wait to play EDH with this card. It will probably be the first commander deck I build after I crack my Kaldheim packs. It will be something to take advantage of the World Tree. And there are awesome combos with Maskwood Nexus, which is also in the set and didn't make my list of overrated cards simply because nobody asks about it. They ask about this card, the World Tree. But what impact does this have on MTG Arena in competitive-ish play, which most of Arena is, except for the Brawl? You know, Brawl's not a joke to me. And I think this is a good card in Brawl, too, especially Historic Brawl. I don't know if Golos is banned in Historic Brawl. But anyway, here's the thing. Much like the guild lands from before, entering the battlefield tapped is a very serious cost for your land. Also, every land that enters the battlefield tapped and doesn't have a type, such as Snow, or doesn't have a dual-faced option, such as Shatterskull Smashing, or doesn't allow your Castle Garenbrig to enter the battlefield untapped, like, these are all very serious costs that slow down your deck, make it clunky, make it awkward, and make it more easy for the opponent to enact their game plan before you get yours rolling. It's a tempo-negative play. So, this entering the battlefield tapped is a serious cost for starters. And it's not, it shouldn't just go in the deck because the deck has green in it. That's crazy. The next part, the best part of the card by far, is the fact that as long as you control six or more lands, lands you control have tap to add a mana of any color. That is sweet. Now we have six lands on the battlefield, and we can use our mana for any color we want, doing whatever the heck we want to do. There are decks that might try to take advantage of this, casting ultimatums of different colors, activating abilities of different colors. I don't know. Is your party deck going to activate to Zuri? I don't, like, let your heart be light. Go wild. Have fun. My issue with that for competitive play is that most decks are designed to play out on a very specific curve in a very specific way. And if you are a deck that, when it gets to six mana, needs mana fixing, oftentimes your deck should have already done the job. I've played a lot with the various ultimatums. I've played a lot with Pathways and Cultivate, Beanstalk Giant, and things like that. Every time I got to seven mana and I wasn't able to cast my Inspired Ultimatum, Emergent Ultimatum, Genesis Ultimatum. I mean, I've been through it all the ultimatums. We done them. Every time I got to that much mana and I wasn't able to cast it, I could always look back at how I played the game and see a point where I made a mistake in my sequencing. Because if you cast Cultivate and then later in the game can't cast Inspired Ultimatum or whatever ultimatum it is, Genesis Ultimatum, you probably messed up your deck building or your sequencing somewhere. And because of that, if you are truly like devoted to this archetype and you're working on your skill as a player, you shouldn't need the World Tree. Now, the World Tree sort of is training wheels, and some people may run it because they don't want to think about what to fetch with their Cultivate. They don't want to pull out the rope to make sure that they get the right lands and sequence them properly. They just want easy mode. World Tree enables it. But that, to me, isn't a good reason to put the card in every single deck that plays green, or to craft it, for that matter. I really think the mana fixing ability is tremendously overrated by some types of players. Maybe it's the Timmies of the world who want the big explosive effect and don't want to work too hard for it. I'm not sure. But for me, that effect doesn't, I don't think it's going to matter. Now, the last part of the card, double Wooburg and a tap to sacrifice the land and go fetch god cards and put them directly onto the battlefield. Yes, I know that you can go fetch Purphoros and a bunch of other hasty gods. Yes, I know. I think that if you're going to use Maskwood Nexus, like Maskwood Nexus into Ironcrag Feet, Deathbell of Warcry is a better combo and quicker and probably gets the job done more efficiently than the World Tree does. I'm not saying that's going to be a thing. I'm just saying it's better. And for the World Tree itself, even though it's very low cost, just sitting on a land, it's not low cost when it comes to 11 freaking mana. It's just not going to happen in most games. It's not going to be an option in most games. And even when it does, most responsibly built decks won't have incredibly powerful god cards that add up to be worth the 11 mana. They might have a few Egon, you know, a couple Jorn the Snow God, that guy. But for the most part, like, responsible decks aren't going to play this overwhelming number of gods. So I do expect there will be people out there doing the nonsense with the World Tree, and some might pull it off in Mythic, but I don't think you're ever going to see the World Tree activated unless things dramatically change in the format with new cards being introduced. But the way things stand, I don't think you'll ever see the 10 mana ability of the World Tree get activated in an event at higher stakes than Mythic rank. I'm talking about tournaments, MPL, event qualifiers, set championships. I can't see it, man. I can't see it. For me, this is over 90% of the time tapped forest. Maybe even more so, because at 6 mana, does it really matter if all your lands produce that many colors? Maybe it's just always tapped forest. And not even a forest. You can't play, your Castle Garenbrig enters untapped. It's not a snow land. You can't activate a Faceless Haven with it. It is by far, in my opinion, the most overrated card in the set. And it is the card that, more than any other, I would really prefer that people not ask every single time I brew a green deck why I'm not building it with the World Tree. I would really love for that to change. But As always, these are my opinions, and part of the joy of watching a video like this is to absolutely dagger me if I get something wrong. So, as we come to the end of the video, remember to hit like, remember to consider hitting subscribe if you enjoyed the video. You stayed until the end. I really appreciate that. Also, you can find ways to support the channel. You can get a YouTube membership. I have some bonus videos going up. You can join Patreon, where you can send me questions and I'll answer them to the best of my ability, as well as post some puppy pictures and my commander deck lists. And you can go get a Twitch Prime Gaming subscription for free if you have Amazon Prime in your household, and support the channel just by clicking over to Twitch and hitting the subscribe button, which costs you nothing if you're an Amazon Prime member. So please support the channel. Thank you. I hope you enjoyed the video. I hope it didn't come off too negative. I hope I didn't get too many card interactions wrong. And more than anything else, I really hope these cards don't just blow up and make me eat my own shoe. Although we'll enjoy it if it does. So, thank you for watching this video. As always, I will see you in the next video. You're cool. Ugh.